Baylor's attendance policy is back in full effect this semester, but not without controversy.
Students have started looking for off-campus housing, and LTVN has tips to aid your search.
And both Baylor men and women's basketball are remaining dominant on the court.
Welcome back to a fresh semester, Baylor family. I'm Nate Smith.
And I'm Joe Pratt. We are coming to you from inside the Lariat newsroom with no shortage of topics heading into the new year. Let's get started.
One issue that is on every college student's mind is when they have to show up for class. But for some, the answer is not so straightforward. LTVN's Pearson Lussie explains.
Baylor has students back on campus for the spring semester, but not without a few mix-ups on attendance policies. Some students are confused whether it is a school-wide mandate that COVID-19 absences count against their attendance because of conflicting policies among colleges.
Not every professor has the same rules. Like in a bigger class, they can't always control attendance, so they're not really counting it.
The policy that students had to attend 75% of their classes has not been enforced campus-wide since over a decade ago.
And basically our policy redirect students to look at the school and college level policies, and then even beyond that into the syllabus where faculty are expected to put their specifics with regard to attendance. So if a student wants to know the ultimate home for attendance for a particular class, they need to look at the syllabus for that class.
Some colleges on campus are enforcing the 75% rule, and some are not, which can be difficult for students to manage. The good news is, as of Thursday, January 27th, the COVID-19 dashboard reports 280 positive cases on campus. That is the lowest number since January 2nd after averaging over 1,000 cases last week. Dr. Null also encouraged students to stay poised for whatever comes their way.
I would just encourage you to be people to be resilient, make a plan in case you test positive, in case you contact trace, stay ahead of your classwork now.
For Lariat TV News, I'm Pearson Lussie.
We've been following Baylor's journey to reach R1 status for some time now, and back in December, they finally achieved it. Sigrid Massey has the details about what's next for the university after this recognition and how it affects students.
It's important to keep in mind that R1 is not a destination. It's really the beginning of of Baylor's identity as a Christian research university.
The university is now several years ahead of their original projected timeline, meaning the Baylor community can expect to see the effects of reaching Research One status sooner rather than later.
It will affect the way that we're able to hire, the way that we're able to recruit faculty, staff, as well as students.
In an episode of Baylor Connections podcast, President Livingstone said, "I think we'll see more and more faculty wanting to be part of Baylor because they can do their academic work at the highest level here and live out their faith as Christians."
And so we'd really like to look at raising our game there. And that means really focusing on things like stronger graduation and retention rates and things of that nature, things that are actually going to be really good for students. But I think the best is still yet to come, and it's just too early to pivot and go in a different direction.
There are already preparations in place to begin the next phase of the Illuminate strategic plan, which include adding 100 faculty members over the next 5 years, expanding the Baylor and Latin America program to increase research, scholarship, and service in those areas, and renovating student housing on campus. For Lariat TV News, I'm Sigrid Massey.
Baylor's Robert Foster Cherry Award is the single largest monetary teaching award presented by a college to an individual. $250,000 was just awarded to Dr. Holly Lynn Lee of North Carolina State by Baylor University. Designed to honor great teachers and stimulate discussion about the value of teaching, the award is given to educators who have proven themselves as extraordinary teachers with positive, inspiring, and long-lasting effects on students. Three finalists lectured at Baylor before Lee was named. She's expected to teach in residence in Waco during the 2023 spring semester.
I'm absolutely going to be enjoying and soaking up every single moment of my semester there. At the minimum, I really see this as creating a great collaboration between the faculty in the Department of Curriculum and Instruction and my faculty that work with me back here at NC State, and I know amazing things are going to happen.
Recently, there have been some frigid temperatures in Central Texas. With a possible winter weather advisory in the forecast, should we start preparing for the worst? LTVN's Katie Kempf takes us down this slippery slope.
If you've stepped outside any time in the past few weeks, you probably noticed the cold temperatures and freezing winds. And with the historic freeze of 2021, many people are left wondering if this year will be the same. Matt Hines, the chief meteorologist at KXXV, may put our fears to rest.
Well, what happened last year is a very rare thing. That happens every 30 to 50 years. So the odds of that happening again are extremely low. Is it impossible to have it in back-to-back years? No, but I think it's extremely low.
After the Texas freeze last year, many students were left without homes. One year ago, we interviewed Will Stogner, who showed the damage in his house, and many students are only hoping it doesn't happen to them.
Basically, what caused it was we had a sprinkler pipe upstairs that completely burst because it was too cold, and who knows how long it was flooding and just flooded the whole house. There was probably 2-3 inches of water everywhere. The walls were soaked, the ceiling had caved in, there was drywall, insulation everywhere.
To attempt to limit property damage, many apartment complexes are informing their residents on how to prevent damage to their units. In this message sent by LL Sam's Historic Lofts, they say to keep off faucet stripping to avoid pipes freezing or bursting, keep the heater on, and keep your windows shut and locked. Even though the freeze may not come, it's always best to be prepared. For Lariat TV News, I'm Katie Kempf.
Another freeze isn't the only housing issue on students' minds, and the largest freshman class in Baylor history may be the reason.
And Greek life came back in full force this semester, including the typical rush process, and COVID-19 joined the fun.
Let there be light. Let there be roommates and teammates and strangers who become family. Let there be marching and cheering. Let there be challenging courses and time to share. Scholarship and championships. Let there be groundbreaking and soul searching. Let there be laughter. Let there be joy. Let there be light.
As the spring semester begins, students have to start considering places to live for next year. As simple as it sounds, the process can become stressful due to the wide variety of options. LTVN's Danielle Skinner shares what you should look for when finding your next home for college.
For many students, living on their own and finding a new place to live is very new to them. So what can you do to make the process of finding your new home easier?
Whether you are in a dorm or looking for a new place to live, there are multiple factors to consider that many people are unaware of.
As a freshman, the housing applications can be a little scary at first, since I really don't know what I'm looking for. Doing research and making sure I knew what hidden fees were included and what utilities were included and such, I was able to make sure that I found the perfect home for me.
Transportation, utilities, and location are huge factors in determining your new home. However, for one girl, living with her best friend was the selling point.
Having your best friend live with you and someone that you know really well and you're comfortable with and you can trust kind of makes it easier living on your own and like away from campus, where you don't have the meal plans and you don't have, you know, the CLs and watching over you.
And some properties recognize that what makes a home isn't where you live, but who you live with. We house many students and make it a priority that they feel comfortable, since for most of them, it's their first time living alone. We match them with roommates and hope that they can take a house and make it a home. For Lariat TV News, I'm Danielle Skinner.
Big events are slowly returning to Baylor in spite of COVID-19. Rush Week was a popular event many students were thrilled to attend prior to classes. However, COVID posed a challenge in that process.
In order to return to campus for sorority recruitment, potential new members were required by Baylor to take 2 PCR tests to participate in in-person activities. However, some experienced Rush Week from home after receiving their test results.
That test came back positive, so I got those results Wednesday and had to go home. So it was like a little upsetting at first because I was like, oh my gosh, like I'm missing the first week of school and like the first week of officially being in a sorority.
Despite not being able to participate in person, Reed said potential new members who tested positive were still able to feel included over Zoom.
So it was fun. And they did a good job with like kind of including the online people, which was really awesome.
Dr. Benjamin J. Ryan explains why Baylor is taking a precautionary approach by implementing COVID tests for students returning to campus.
The reason being, there's a lot of universities that are starting online in the spring semester. And what we really wanted to focus on is being in person, and we believe we can do that in the safest possible way.
Dr. Ryan believes Baylor is likely to transition into an endemic phase in the next month or so, bringing student life and events on campus closer to normal.
What we're trying to do is slow the spread down enough that we can continue to live a campus life and students can enjoy their time at Baylor and faculty can teach their classes as planned.
For Lariat TV News, this is Danica Young.
This weekend and this weekend only, Waco Civic Theater is having their youth musical, Tuck Everlasting, a show about a girl and her adventure with an immortal family. The group has been working on the musical since December, and they are excited to finally showcase their work.
What I love about youth shows is that eventually, at some point during the show, kids eventually take ownership. They're like, this is my show. That happened at like the second rehearsal this go around. I mean, they were just like, this is ours, we're gonna take it and we're gonna blow it out of the water.
If you'd like to see the musical, learn more about upcoming shows and events, or get involved, you can go to wacocivictheater.com for more information.
The oldest continually operating university in Texas is turning 177 years old. In February of 1845, the Republic of Texas President Anson Jones put pen to paper and Baylor University was officially chartered. In order to commemorate the founding of the university, Baylor is holding a birthday-themed Dr. Pepper Hour, Tuesday, February 1st. The festivities will include photo opportunities with birthday-themed props, a visit from President Livingstone and the First Gent, and green and gold cupcakes to go along with the traditional Dr. Pepper floats.
If you're in need of a break and want time to relax, the Slick may have the perfect service for you. Baylor's massage therapist Kim Ballmer has worked with students for over 22 years, providing them massage therapy tailored for college students. A 30-minute massage is $40 and an hour is $65. You can schedule an appointment at the Slick service desk.
With students and helping them with all sorts of different problems, from orthopedic problems and old injuries to just stress management. I'd like to work with the clients and the students and help them to figure out ways to take care of themselves, do self-care for aches and pains or just stress.
Coming up, Baylor is hoping for another semester of athletic dominance after a great fall term.
And Baylor men and women's basketball are ranked among the best in the country. This weekend, they're hoping they'll continue that trend. We'll be right back.
Waking up to another light. No more sorrow and no more night. You're the light, let it shine now. Let it shine now.
As part of the Big 12 SEC Challenge, fourth-ranked Baylor men's basketball is playing the Alabama Crimson Tide in Tuscaloosa Saturday. Baylor has the best record in the challenge's history, with a record of 7-1. This will be the seventh meeting between the teams. Alabama leads the series 4-2, while Baylor won their last meeting in 2019, 73-68.
We know that everybody in the team can start, and we're not a one-man show. We can always like go into the bench and get somebody who can bring us a spark. And I really feel like we always play for each other. So whether we're missing one person or we're missing two, we always try to push each other to keep on getting better.
Baylor women's basketball is now just one game back of the Big 12 leader Iowa State in the conference standings, thanks to the Bears' road win over Texas Tech earlier this week, 88-80. Although they escaped with the win, the Bears struggled defensively, allowing the Lady Raiders to shoot a scorching hot 52.8% from the field. Head coach Nikki Collins' squad will look to improve on the defensive end of the court this Saturday when they're set up for a 1 o'clock matchup with West Virginia in Morgantown.
You know, and the big difference for them is in their wins, they get 24 points off turnovers a game, and in their losses, they get 13. So if they can turn you over and get in transition, they're really, really good. If you don't cough up the basketball and can defend them in the half court on every possession, you have a chance to win.
Two Bears took home the weekly Big 12 honors in track and field this week. Johnny Brackens, and Akira Nugent. Brackens was the conference's men's athlete of the week. He had the highest long jump mark in the country last week at 25.6 1/4, and also took home the gold in his first ever indoor triple jump competition. Nugent picked up the conference's co-women's athlete of the week honors after having a record-setting weekend of her own. Nugent broke meet, facility, and program records in her last meet. Her time of 7.9 seconds in the 60-meter hurdles was also good for second in the country. Baylor softball is getting ready to start the 2022 season, led by longtime head coach Glenn Moore. The team is set to open against Tennessee Martin in the Lady Demon Classic on Friday, February 11th in Natchitoches, Louisiana, and will host the Oregon Ducks a week later for the home opener.
I think this team could be one of those that flies under the radar a little bit, but certainly a hungry team, a team that's got a lot of tools. We've got the ability to go back to more of our speed game.
And that's all for Baylor Athletics. Let's hope for another great semester.
We'll be with you every step of the way this year, so be sure to check the latest news at BaylorLariat.com.
We're looking forward to seeing you again. From Lariat TV News, have a great weekend, and Sic 'em Bears.